Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I want to invite the kids to come up and play with us if we have any kids here today that want to. There's some gum. Do you want to play the instruments? Thank you. All right, you guys ready? Rhythm, ready? Get it. A couple of announcements before we get started. The important one is right after worship today, we are having a new member class. And so if you are interested in becoming a member of the congregation, if you are interested, maybe you are a member and you've forgotten a few things about how the denomination runs or the foundations of the essentials of our faith, you're welcome to attend as well. We got some pizza coming, which will be awesome. From Burlado's across the street is Pitch. I don't usually do ads, but they're fantastic. So we got some pizza coming over, and so we're going to sit and enjoy some time together as we learn what it is to be a member of what it should be, to be a member of the church, of the congregation. Next week, if you are, I'm going to go ahead and announce this just now. So next week, we've got in the Sunday school class that meets in the fellowship hall, folks are going to be gone for graduations and whatnot, and so they're going to be postponing a week, skipping over next week, and going and meeting again in 2 weeks, just so you all know that that is coming up. In the coming weeks, we've got graduate recognition day, grad recognition day. That's on the 21st of May, and so we're going to be lifting up the folks that are graduating from high school. Next week is Mother's Day. Now, next week is Mother's Day. Typically, Mother's Day is the second best attended church service in the year. Traditionally, right? Yeah, more than Easter almost. It's right there. But the reason that it is because typically moms, when the kids say, well, what do you want for Mother's Day? I want my family all together in worship, in church. And so the kids begrudgingly come to church. let's do that again. Let's do that again. Yeah. So next week's Mother's Day, following week's grad Sunday, we're going to have the kids choir singing here pretty soon in one of these weeks. We've got the Mother's Day Out kids are going to come and sing for us in one of these weeks. So there's some good stuff going on. Please come as you can. We would greatly appreciate it. I think that's all the announcements I want to lift up today. So let's go ahead and get into it. Would you please stand as we join together in our call to worship? Come, people of God, take refuge in the Lord who listens when we cry out.
Who rescues us when we call, and who leads and guides us toward his unfailing love.
You are our God. Our lives are in your hands.
Let us worship God together. Amen.
Amen. Let's sing the church's one foundation. Jesus Christ. Go. Designs that people have today. I mean, I saw a Millennium Falcon Lego set. You know the Millennium Falcon? Star Wars? You notice it?
The fastest ship in the galaxy.
Okay, no. So anyway, saw a Millennium Falcon made out of Legos. It was about this big. It's unbelievable. It's awesome. We didn't have all that. We had wood rectangles that you put one on top of the other. That was kind of how it worked. And so you could make all kinds of stuff. You had to use your imagination, right? So you could make a garage for your toy car. You could make a castle that then Godzilla would come and knock down, right? That kind of stuff. Today in church, we're going to talk a little bit about building blocks. And we're going to talk about, we already sang about Christ as the foundation. It's kind of like the base of a building, right? And then you use the blocks, bricks, to build the building on top. Guess what the bricks are that we use to build the church? You. And you, you're a building block. She's a building block. So is she, and so are all these people. And so are supposed to be all the people that aren't here today. Oh, did I speak out of turn? I'm going to read this in a little bit, but I want you all to hear this. This is Peter. Peter's called Peter the Rock, because Christ renamed him the Rock, because he was the rock on which they were going to build the church. But he's telling us this. He says, come to him being Jesus, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And this part, and like living stones, let yourself be built into a spiritual house. We're the stones that are supposed to be built into the spiritual house. What happens if somebody who's building a building forgets to put a brick in the right place? Yeah, maybe not right away, right? Maybe not right away. Maybe he's building a wall and he just forgets that spot and he puts the brick in the next spot and he keeps going. And at first it looks like it's holding fine, right? But little by little, the weight of everything up above starts to press down on that missing, that space where the block is missing. And then the wall cracks. And then the crack gets bigger and bigger. And one brick that's missing eventually makes the wall fall down. Yeah? That's kind of how we are. Not so much as the church around the world, because, you know, the church is never going to fail. But as a congregation, as a family, if one of the bricks is missing, it may look okay right away. For a little while, it may look fine. But eventually, the wall starts to crack. Yeah. So I want you guys, when you leave today, to remember how important you are to this building, this community that we have here. Because when you're gone, there's a hole that doesn't get filled. You're important. Okay? Remember that. God sees you as important. Yeah. Right, exactly right. She said, maybe if somebody's building a house and he forgets to put some of the blocks in, sometimes it just falls down. You're right. Cement will hold it up for a little bit longer, but eventually the weight still gets you. So let's pray that our wall gets to hold and stay firm. Yeah, let's pray that this building of our community here gets to stay standing. Lord God, we thank you for everyone that you've brought together, all of these living stones that you are using to build your community today. Help us to remember how important we are, each one of us, to the building of this building, this community, this church. And help us not to be the hole that causes the wall to get a crack in it. I thank you and I praise you for this opportunity and for your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to read from that passage from 1 Peter now. We're going to start 1 Peter chapter 2, starting here on verse 2. He writes this, like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believe, he is precious, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once, you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." Let's pray. Father God, it is an amazing privilege to be able to gather here today to lift up our praises to you, to pray knowing that you listen. Creator of the universe, so much going on, and yet you are here with us listening, desiring us to share with you the thoughts, the concerns, the joys, the celebrations, the struggles of our lives, each one of us, and that is amazing. We thank you for that. Thank you for that privilege. We thank you for the love that is behind it. We thank you for the care with which you watch over us. We thank you for giving us what we need each day, our daily bread that sustains us, that keeps us going, that helps us to know that we're not alone and that every step that we take is one in which we can rejoice because you're there. Sometimes those steps, Lord, are difficult to take. They're truly steps out in faith. It's a lot easier to go home and lock the doors, turn off the television so the outside world doesn't invade us, to just sit and ignore what's going on in this world around us and just to be. Eventually, though, that's not what you've called us to be. We are called to be your hands and feet. We are called to be a place of refuge. We are, as a family, called to give sanctuary to those who are struggling with what's going on in their lives. We remember those in Dallas who've been affected by, yet again, another shooting. We remember all those in Sudan who are struggling with another war. The world seems to be determined to tear itself apart. My God, wouldn't it be easy just to ignore it all? But that's not what you would do. And so that's not what we will do. So guide us. Lead us to the occasions where we can offer grace, where we can offer mercy without judgment, where we can offer love without expecting anything in return. Only then will we look anything like the kingdom of God that you're building. use us as you see fit. And in the end, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father. We pray all of this, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And we ask that you hear us now as we lift up the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's say it together. Lord, you are more precious than silver. Humans, but was chosen and carefully put in place by God as the cornerstone for the new people of God. Now, I'm not a mason, never done any masonry, but if you don't know, I figured it out. I went and Googled it and all that stuff, but if you haven't figured out what a cornerstone is, I'm going to talk about that for a second. The cornerstone is the very first stone put in place for the foundation of a stone building. It is cut perfectly so that all of the angles are a perfect 90 degrees, right? And it's laid in place so that the edges of the stone point exactly in the direction that the walls are going to go. It's perfect in form and in function. It's what's called true. Capital T, right? Place it exactly right, and it's true. And because it is true, because it is perfectly cut and perfectly oriented, then the other bricks, the other stones that get laid, can be placed with confidence because as long as they are in alignment with the cornerstone, they are expanding up and out in exactly the right direction. Now, when we think of Jesus, It's easy to see how his being the cornerstone for our lives makes sense. Because we want to grow in exactly those directions as well, right? But what's important for us to remember this morning is that the cornerstone isn't just the guy. It's part of the wall. You don't take the stone out once you have the wall started. The cornerstone stays in place forever. Or until you renovate and take that. But it's supposed to stay forever. As a support, as a guide for the bricks that are laid afterwards. The bricks that come afterward reflect, both in form and function, the master mason's plan that is evident from the orientation of the cornerstone. Fair enough? And our gospel reading today is going to touch on the same idea this morning. So if you have your Bibles handy, let's turn to the Gospel of John. We're going to be reading in John 14. Some of you have heard this recently if you were here at the funeral on Friday. John 14 says this. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How do we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Well, Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father and we'll be satisfied. And Jesus said to him, have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How could you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And if in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. This is the word of God for the people of God today.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, so this reading this morning actually comes during the Last Supper gathering. The disciples have eaten, Judas has run off. Jesus has told the disciples by this time that he was leaving them, and Peter was just told that he would deny Christ three times. Having heard all that, the disciples were depressed, let's say. So at the beginning of this reading, we hear Jesus tell his disciples not to be depressed, not to be troubled. Just trust him, he says. He says he was leaving, but he was going on to prepare a place for his followers in his Father's house. He said he was going to go, and then he was going to come back and take them to his Father's house to be with him. Understand here, Jesus didn't say, I'm going to give you directions to where I'm going. He didn't say, I'm going to come back and point out to you the path to walk. No, he says, I'm coming back and I will take you with me. Remember, Thomas says, Lord, we don't know the way because we don't know where you're going. And, of course, Jesus responds with one of the most powerful I am statements that he makes at his time on earth. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then he says, if you really know me, you will know my Father as well. And from now on, you will know him because you've seen me. He said, I am the way. I don't have to point to the way. I am the way, and I will lead you to the Father. I will show you the Father, unlike anyone who has ever been or ever will be, because the Father and I are one. We're connected in a very unique way. He says, I'm the truth. Or if we use the language we were using earlier with our language, Peter 1, 1 Peter reading, I am true. I am perfect in form and function. I am unwaveringly focused and pointed to the Father and to His will. Nothing I've said or done is out of character with God the Father. And because of that, you can trust. You can believe in me. And if you believe, he says, you will join me in the Father's work and do some pretty amazing stuff yourself. Remember what he said? You will do things that I'm doing, and even greater things, because I am going. That's pretty cool. He says, I'm the life. If you take my hand and walk in the way, and if you stay true to the path that I desire to walk with you, follow the trueness of my example and my instruction, then you will find yourself walking into abundant and eternal life from the very first step. He says, I'll be with you always. This is the part I want to focus on for the rest of our time. That if you believe in me, you will do the works I've been doing. And even greater things. And there's the lesson. There's our lesson for this passage today. That we as a community of those who say we believe in Christ Jesus, we have the potential to be the reflections of Christ in the world. To reflect his lessons, to reflect his priorities, to reflect his works in the world around us. Going back to that 1 Peter passage again, it is the cornerstone named Jesus that started the foundation of the church, and it is the cornerstone named Jesus upon whom we come together. As Peter said, we are the living bricks, living stones that come together to build the church. We're shaped by the mason. Capital M, to resemble the cornerstone that we are laid upon and beside and on top of, to create the church. What Peter said was a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that we may declare the praises of him who called us out of darkness. Peter's laying out for us the summary of church. The function, the form of church. It's all laid right here. William Barclay, theologian, writes that there are three things we can learn here about the church and about the role that each one of us has to play as a stone in this edifice. One, we have been given privilege. Because of Jesus, we've been offered a new and more intimate relationship with God. The Spirit of God has come to live within us and continues to smooth over those rough edges and sharpen our angles so that we can look more like that cornerstone. And that's a privilege that God the Father, our mason, continues to work on us. It's not always fun. It's not always comfortable. But God is forever working on us to make us more like the cornerstone. Two, we've been charged with obedience. The bricks don't get to choose to go in a different direction. The mason sets them together so they might remain true to the direction of his vision. Three, we've been set to do service. Our honor is that we get to be a servant of God. We get to understand what privilege is. And we understand that if God's will is to be done, that we need to respond to our call in obedience. We're going to talk about our membership vows in a little while at the membership class. Do you remember what, if you joined the church, do you remember what the vow was that you take? That you vow to be a part of the church through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness. They added that last one in a few years ago. Prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness. Pray for your church. Be present in your church. Be in service with your church and to your church. Witness. Celebrate your life with Christ and how we do here in the church. We can do all this because of the cornerstone that was laid before us. All of this is possible because we believe and we trust in the direction, the orientation in which he was placed and that he directs us in. We believe it's true. True. And it is the way to go. You ever have those times when you don't know what direction you're headed in? You don't know which way you're going? It's hard to know about the direction of life. You ever have those moments? If you think about it, the brick doesn't know how long the wall's going to be or how high it's going to go. Each brick just knows their part in the wall. And each brick finds purpose and contentment in following the way, the direction, and the strength provided by the cornerstone. So when those times of fear and feelings of doubt creep in, reconnect with your cornerstone. Check your orientation. Lean on him. Refocus on staying in alignment. Together, you can be true. And you can rejoice in building not just the church, but your life together. And that was God saying, Amen. Well, if God says amen, I suppose we ought to stop. We come to the table, as we do each week, for the spiritual nourishment, for the encouragement that communing with God through Christ gives us. Today, I hope that as we come to this table, once again, we're not just looking for strength, but we're looking for that cornerstone alignment. And remember the promises that God has made through Christ to each one of us, that he will never leave us. He'll always be there to use us towards his will. So let's, in that mindset, let's come to the table. It is the first Sunday of the month, and so, as such, we will be doing our whole communion liturgy, so we'll start at the beginning. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ,
we are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let's stand and offer one another the peace of Jesus Christ together. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke the bread, giving it to his disciples and saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which I am giving for you. As often as you eat, eat in remembrance of me." And so the Lord Jesus be with them. When the supper was over, he took the cup and again gave thanks. He gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the cup of the new covenant, being poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. And as often as you drink it, drink in remembrance of me." And so again, Lord Jesus, we remember. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves, Father, in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. My communion helpers may come forward. Okay. brought you here. Holy Spirit calls you now to this table. Please come as you feel ready. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we have communed together. We are truly a family. And as such, we get to share one another's lives together. So, joys and concerns that we lift up, that we can pray for you and celebrate with you. Anybody got anything to share today other than Zeta? did you see that? I didn't look back. I knew his hands. Yes, sir. I'll come back to you, Zeta.
Yesterday, one of our mining operations, a 25,000 volt line broke and was laying across one of our pieces of heavy equipment with an operator inside. He was trapped for 4 hours, but was able to get out eventually unharmed.
Nice.
Very grateful.
Yeah. That's good. Did you hear all that?
Wow.
That 25,000 volt power line that fell across a piece of heavy equipment with the operator of the equipment inside. And so he was trapped there for 4 hours, and the people on the ground were able to safely extract him and cut the power, and it all turned out good. So, hallelujah. Thanks for sharing that. Who else?
We
did have a birthday yesterday. Kay's birthday was yesterday. She's 39.
Yes, 25
is not believable. 39.
He asked 25.
Sorry. 39. Let's go with that. Yes, happy birthday.
Thank you. We all had a birthday in your family.
Yes, our oldest daughter had her birthday yesterday. She's 31 now, so that's pretty exciting. Anybody else? Zeta, that's your turn.
My hair mysteriously disappeared.
Your hair mysteriously disappeared. You look good. Yeah, you look good. So hopefully that means that that job offers will be flooding in.
Just hope it's worth it.
I just hope this haircut is worth it. Yes, sir.
Dave's back.
We're praying for Dave's back today. It was a long day yesterday. He went to bed and he woke up, couldn't move that much. So, but you know what? You're here. Yeah. Bad back, falling in the bedroom or wherever, and couldn't get up, but you made it.
I'm here.
God bless you for that. And we're praying healing on your back, for sure. I know Josh Therapist said he doesn't get back.
Does she work sometimes?
No, but she might make it a small exception. Well, brothers and sisters, let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the joy, we thank you for the laughter, we thank you for the connection that we are able to build in community. It is an amazing thing when people who are called to love one another truly, truly do, and that is an amazing thing. So we thank you for that. We lift up all of the joys that we've heard. We lift up the concerns that we know of, and all the things that have gone unspoken too, Lord. We know that you know the thoughts on our hearts already. So we lift all those prayers up to you, knowing that not only that you hear us, but that you care. And that is an amazing, amazing idea. And so we thank you for all of that. You've given us so many blessings, but Lord, we continue to pray for more and more blessings in this world, that you trust us with more and more, and that we live into that trust, knowing that we each have a place, we each have a role to play in your kingdom here in this world. As we move now to the time for our morning offering, Lord, we acknowledge that, again, everything we have has been entrusted to us by you. And so we take a moment to give back a small part of those blessings. We ask that you receive this offering in the spirit in which it's given, bless it, multiply it, and guide us in our usage of it, so that we truly might make a great impact for your church, for your kingdom. I pray all this in the name of Jesus our Christ. Amen. 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 If our ushers will go ahead and take our offering, let's do that. of my favorites. I think it is one of the shortest, how great thou art.
Oh Lord my God. Jesus came and lived and died and rose again for us, and that your Holy Spirit guides, strengthens us now and forever. Amen. and honor now. Have a great, great week. We'll see you next Sunday. Then sings my soul.